Welcome back. So recently, the former CBN governor, Mr. Charles Soludo, said that you did not leave any tangible legacy in your state. You have, of course, since dismissed these comments. Can I ask you to explain why Mr. Soludo is wrong?
If I want people to ask me, what did you do in Anambra State? I said I brought civility and order in government, in governance. At least I brought an ordered behavior. You see, often a time, are people looking for physical infrastructure as a model? No. There's a difference between even people having what you call ordered behavior.
So inculcating a culture.
A culture of ordered behavior, a pattern, a discipline. And people can say, this man is doing the right thing. I brought an ordered behavior to the government. If that is the only thing, the rest let the people judge. Think about what happened in education. We were number 24 when I started. When I left for 3 years, we were number one, both in work and NECO. So what else? Maybe people were expecting me to build a twin tower. No, that is not what is required now. What is required now in Nigeria is to bring civility and order and to do things in a structured manner that we can build a better place. What is the most important thing in the human being? Education. Why are we celebrating Asian countries? The reason why we are celebrating Asian countries is in the 70s and 80s, while they were busy educating their people, we were busy picnicking and celebrating and dancing. And suddenly now, even if you go to schools, the so-called Ivy League schools in America and everything, they've taken it over. Kellogg was founded by a famous man, Kellogg Graduate School. By the time he finished, after spending 57 years there, the next person that he handed over was an Indian. Why is India powering today? Because of ICT. And what is ICT? Education. So I invested in education. That is the most critical legacy anybody can leave.
Now, before I leave the Soludo comments and go to other things, just quickly, part of the criticism was that you left too much money in the coffers at a time when he believed that there was actually things you could do
No, let me tell you. Development has a pattern and time. As a governor, when I started, there was no planning in the state. I set up Ministry of Planning. Before I became governor, if you come from Asaba to Onitsha, it is like somebody who went from heaven to hell. And if you move from Onitsha to Asaba, it's like somebody who went from hell to heaven. Today, I've been able to come into Onitsha and build a 10 lane up to 6 roundabout. In Mpo, where there's the biggest congestion, I work with federal government into building a flyover there. Because one of the things that I was doing, when people say I left too much money, is that where I think things are critical for me, rather than go and spend the limited resources of the state, I try to look for federal government, development partners, assistance in other areas. What we did in terms of the money we left, if you're operating with a depleting asset, you must save for the future. And I'll give you an example. Somebody told me yesterday, said, the foreign currency component of your saving is about $170 million, which is like about 40 billion. Which state in Nigeria can say they have 40 billion?
Okay, so all these achievements under, you know, the banner of APGA, the party that essentially took you to successful elections twice. And yet, you've left.
One day,
and join the ruling PDP.
One day.
Why?
One day, one, that is not for today. I can tell you. No, 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 it's not for today.
There's something decidedly odd about abandoning ship.
There's women, there's husbands and wives that have abandoned the richest people in the world and divorced them. Maybe because they're not wanted, maybe because of irreconcilable differences. Take it that I left APGA in that manner. You know,
the difficulty for people, for example, let me tell you what I always tell people. Yeah.
Nobody stays in a place you're no longer wanted. There's something I always tell my wife. I said, we're married. I own the house in which we live. But any day you don't want me again, I'll leave the house for you. When I left England, I lived in London for 10 years and I bought a house. When I was living in London, I said to my wife, I'm going, you know, to my country. I don't have anything to do with white man again. I've returned whatever belongs to them. This house, because it's my house, I don't owe any mortgage in it. It belongs to you and your children. Even if you don't want me to come into it again, I won't come into it. So for me, that's the situation APGA is. They don't want me again.
The point is, you talk about APGA as something that is almost removed from you. As someone who was senior in the party, you are seen as actually a stakeholder.
No, in APGA. I was a foundation, and I made APGA what it is.
Exactly. So why would you abandon something that you started to build?
Let me tell you, I had a company that I was owing 40%. 40% of the company, very big company in this country. When they started quarreling, I left it. Nothing is worth a quarrel.
This is at odds with your nature that we saw when you were fighting for your mandate.
Let me tell you what I did when I just said, throughout the time I was in court, never did you see me use bad language. Never did you see me call the man who benefited. All I did is say, I want the court to end. You didn't know when the problem in APGA started. It started over a period, and then when it got to the end where I feel it's okay, I left.
Let us take a break. When we return, we speak to Mr. Obi about life before and after public office. Stay with us.